Hello. My name is Shane Nikat and I am presenting West Indies Calling, a perception given of Caribbean service of World War II. To note that the director is actually John Page, but there's not much information on him online. But the production company that did the documentary is Rosa Productions, and their other documentaries are very similar, actually, in style. So, Paul Rotha, who's a British documentary filmmaker, film historian and critic. He worked for the BBC documentary department. He's actually head of it at a point in time. And he often collaborated with John Grierson and did work a lot for the British Ministry of Information. Right, the notable film that he did later on in his career was ACT Speaks, and it was based on a post-war depiction of the city of Manchester. It showed the past, present, and future of it. One thing about Luther is that how he was a master scripting the real world, as in the way how he would depict the world to his viewers, you would think that it was like a utopia. So, you'll see more of that in a short clip. So, before we continue, I just want to show you a clip from the documentary.
This is Larry Constantine. I'd like to say a few words about the many hundreds of West Indians who have come over here to help on the factory budget. Here in a trading center in the north of England are 82 of them. People from all walks of life, including doctors, lawyers, reporters from the West Indies. They're being taught side by side with Englishmen and women to operate all the latest types of machinery. In 16 weeks, they must know how to read blueprints, micrometers, slide rules, to set up and operate lathes, capstans, drills, and grinders. When their training is complete, they will go to aircraft or ordnance factories or machine shops. There are also others from several West Indian islands who volunteered and were chosen for their skill, and on arrival were immediately introduced into production in the united effort to beat Hitler and his gang.
Right, and I'm going to show you one more thing. It's actually a montage.
Thank you.
from the two clippings, can anyone tell me what aspects the filmmaker tried to promote? Just some observation.
Aspects in terms of...
Filmmaker tried to promote.
You mean the modes you're talking about in particular?
Not modes. Tried to promote, as in, what did he try to promote in the film itself?
Like the fact that the mix between the racial classes and how they're having fun and friendly.
Yeah, that's one. Before I dive into that, a little bit about the film, right? The film can be considered a propaganda film, because it was made by the British Empire to sell a sort of perception of how Crimean people were involved in the war, or how it was perceived back then. It was used to lure the West Indians to fight against Hitler. It showed different aspects of the English army in which the West Indian people contributed. Factories, air force, hospitals, lumber yards. It was carefully scripted, and it's really well edited. It's a nice cinematography, which you would be considered at that point in time, which is really nice. And Kaiso music, so it kind of kept that local feel, right, when you're showing it to everyone. So it made a very optimistic movie. The two modes that I noticed from this documentary was the expository mode and the reflexive mode. The expository mode, because it did have a sort of voice of God that did emphasize argumentative logic, supporting that how the West Indians were making a difference to the war. And it also had a reflexive mode, which it depicted a sort of truth, but not the real truth. You know that how it's edited, that was sort of scripted. But you let it look like you consider it, so you
Oh, Shane, I'm just after that now.
Yeah.
With the modes, mm-hmm. And you could correct me if I'm wrong, but I'll maybe add the performative, because of the fact it is, because of propaganda, so that lures into the law of the subjective nature of the filmmaker.
You think performative, I'll check in here, I think performative is when...
It's the subjective nature of the filmmaker. So the mere fact that is brainwashing propaganda, that is subjectivity in its highest form.
Mm-hmm.
So just that, but yeah.
Right, yeah. So you two aspects that the filmmaker tried to promote was, one was equality. The film focuses on gender and racial equality. It shows both black and white people working, socializing, even dancing together. Depicting almost like brothers and sisters in arms fighting against Hitler. Women are shown as nurses, receptionists, factory workers in the British Army. Back then, remember, that's how gender equality wasn't a big factor, so they really pushed that. As you can see from the pictures there, in the last picture there is actually Jimmy Hyde, who's an Air Force pilot. He enters a sort of lounge, and the guys walk up and light a cigarette for him.
No, just a response. Like you said, it was brainwashing. But how could it be brainwashing when it's stating something factual?
No, propaganda. When you get in someone to fight for you infringe on a sort of ideological framework in that person to fight for you, so it's manipulation. So subjective in our nature.
A lot of things that they showed there, that wasn't the reality of things. They probably were getting paid so little and weren't as happy to work there anyway.
Yeah, so I'll get to all that. The second aspect that the filmmakers tried to promote was skilled labor. Now, back in the 1930s and 1940s, was an economic depression for the West Indies, right? In Dr. Paddington's paper, he wrote, it's prompted the idea that there were many skilled positions available, especially the scenes of Caribbean men and women working alongside English men and women using latest types of machinery. When you first clip in, you saw that, right? And they also promoted the idea that when the war is over, because you're coming and you're volunteering to work in the British Army, you will be trained in skills, in some sort of skill for trade. Right? Like Ulrich Cross, he states in the documentary, when peace comes, the increase in public transport means a new career for many of us who have done the job. He was an Air Force pilot. Also, what I thought about talking heads, back then racism was still rampant. And so, yes, to him. Yeah. Sir Eric Cross, he was an Air Force pilot, and he actually became lead squadron leader later on. He was only talking heads. Sir Larry Constantine, who you know was a world famous cricketer and became a politician, and Una Mason. She was a Jamaican poet and activist, and very well respected. So they used these three people who actually considered tolerable to the British, to the white people back then. And it sort of made an appeal to them as well. So reasons and factors for making. The UK needed volunteers to fight against Germany, of course, right? The Empire wanted to show its power and influence in the war by enlisting the services of its colonies. So again, the film was made firstly with the intention of the local British, right? Their audience was actually made for them. And you wanted to show that how it's like the empire is still big, still broad, but it was a lie, of course, because British Guiana and British and British Guiana and Belize were the only probably two colonies back then. West Indian people were victims of racial discrimination during the First World War, and it resulted in strikes all over the Caribbean. So during the First World War, they were paid meager wages and treated terribly. And when they came back home, they started to throw riots and strikes like throughout the Caribbean, and it settled and picked back up. It fluctuated. More readings on that. I mean, you get more information on that from John Howard's reading. Right, strikes and riots also continue because of low wages, because the economy is going down. After the First World War, sugar industry was in critical condition. It was already in critical condition, but the First World War basically sustained the sugar industry for a while. But then afterwards, when the peace came, it started to plummet. And throughout the Caribbean, their main source of income was agriculture exports, and natural disasters like hurricane and so forth also crippled it. So there was an economic depression, and therefore it increased the cost of living. So West Indians looked sort of like desperate. So the filmmakers actually used this, if you think about it, as a perfect marketing scheme where, hey, you want better life, come and volunteer, doing some trades, come back. As it is. So it's actually a 15-minute excerpt, if you think about it, actually 1,300 feet of film, 1,300 feet of film from a previous series from the British Ministry of Information called Hello West Indies. Right? And then in 1941, they were Luther Productions were hired to take the footage and create West Indies Calling. And they did a budget of £630. And the film was created with the intention of domestic audiences in England. Right, but later on, they found out how they could actually carry it across. It was reviewed in 1944 and 1946 by the Monthly Film Bulletin. The latter review suggested that the film would have been more interesting for British audiences if it had been possible to show something of the speakers' homes. And of course, in more modern times, when Professor Wendy Webster of Cambridge University, she did a review she analyzed it actually and said how the film was unique or highly unusual in three ways. Firstly, it showed ethnic diversity in the home front, which is Britain for that time. It included black women's active involvement in the war, which is a part of the war that no one never sees. You will see like white soldiers, American and English Kalinia, females, foreground black people are on active service in the background. So it it highlighted that everyone had a role.
Any questions? Alrighty then. So let's thank Shane again for a very thorough performance.